So it seems like because of COVID-19, a lot of people are being more introspective than usual. They're thinking outside the box and they're really reassessing what is and isn't actually practical. And in times like this, where we're facing a global pandemic, people are realizing that government intervention is necessary. We need leadership. We need to be able to arm ourselves with the capability to deal with these types of issues. And it goes beyond COVID-19. But what I think that people need to do, just generally speaking, is try to think bigger than what we usually think through in times like this. Like, a lot of people are looking at what's practical, what do we need? And obviously, it's healthcare, right? We need people to have access to tests. It needs to be free. If they have COVID-19, obviously the treatment should be free, but it shouldn't just be free for that, because there are other illnesses that people deal with, and it shouldn't take a global crisis to make us acknowledge the necessity of healthcare in this country. It shouldn't just be a global pandemic to where we realize maybe there is a need for healthcare for everyone. And, you know, part of me is cynical because, you know, elites want to make sure that the working class don't have COVID-19, because this is a disease that doesn't discriminate. So if poor people get it, rich people are going to get it too. You know, but we have to expand our thinking even further than that. When we're faced with a global pandemic, this is something that's unique to a lot of us. We haven't dealt with this. You know, we have no experience, and the most that we've seen are only like, you know, introduction to global pandemics is from the movies, you know, if you've watched Contagion. So we don't know what we're dealing with. And this is also going to lead to an increase in mental health crises as well. People may watch the news and feel anxiety, and if they have panic disorder already, feel like, you know, they're more nervous than usual. If you have obsessive compulsive disorder, this will certainly exacerbate that. So we have to make sure that we think not just about our physical well-being, but the mental well-being and the toll that this takes on people at a time where they're self-quarantining. And we have to look out for individuals with depression, you know, who may be susceptible to self-harm. We have to think outside the box. And I think that we've kind of just been conditioned in the United States in this ruthless capitalist system to, you know, look out for ourselves and just think about the immediate need of things and, you know, what we do and don't need. But these things are also really important. These things are really important. And if you have a mental health crisis, then what do during a self-quarantine? What do? I mean, a lot of people in this country, they can't afford to just go see a therapist. It's costly. And even if we set up a system to where you can call a therapist via Skype and have them prescribe you medication, one, we don't have that in place. But two, how would you do that if you can't afford it? And a lot of people, if you have a crisis, if you have a breakdown, you show up at the ER if you don't have insurance. That's your primary care physician if you're poor and you don't have insurance. But then you may be causing more harm to yourself because you're exposing yourself to illnesses, potentially COVID-19, at the ER facility. So there's a lot of issues. And I want people to think through the cascading effects of these types of global pandemics. And I want you to apply this thinking, not just to COVID-19, but to every single issue, to healthcare. Like, if you have a healthcare crisis, what is that going to do for someone psychologically? Student loan debt, how does that affect people's mental health, depression, and whatnot? And not only that, how does that affect their loved ones? If you're dealing with someone who is facing mental health crises and they can't get help for it, like, these are times when we have to really expand our range of thinking and not just think about the direct consequences of issues, but indirect consequences of issues as well. And this goes beyond mental health. Like, there's countless examples. What do? If you're an elderly person, you live by yourself, and, you know, you have no relatives around you to look out for you, and you're kind of on your own. You drive yourself to the grocery store. You pick up your own medications. Like, my family knew someone like this. We lived by a lady like this before she died, who had no one until we came along and were that family that looked out for her and kind of adopted her. So, like, what do if you don't have anyone? Who's going to pick up the groceries for elderly people who have to self-quarantine? Who is going to babysit the children who are home from school if you still have to go to work? Maybe you're lucky enough to where your job allows you to work from home while you self-quarantine. But you still, if you have like a 2-month-old who's crying and you're working, what do you do in that situation? Like, I have great nephews who are very young and they're loud, so you still need someone to tend to them. Like, we've just become so accustomed to kind of just like let people deal with things on their own, to where when we have these types of crises, like, it's not just the crisis itself, it's the ripple effect, you know, the crises that are created by the main crisis that we have to think about. And I'm really, you know, it feels good to see people think about, you know, the policies that we need in terms of UBI. Like, it's astonishing to see Mitt Romney propose UBI, which I'm cautious of, because that can be a right-wing policy that hurts us if not implemented the correct way. But I mean, people are clearly thinking outside the box. But at this time, I want everyone to try to use this opportunity to think deeper about the way that policies impact people. And the reason why we haven't been thinking about policies and the real concrete impact that crises have on people and, you know, how policies can address them is because we live in a ruthlessly capitalistic system to where every aspect of our lives has been economized. We're not thinking about the real human impact on people. We're thinking about the market impact, right? We're not thinking about how X affects humans or Y affects humans. We're thinking about how this will impact the stock market. Human beings are just cogs in a machine. And I want to influence people, no matter what your political ideology is, to really think deeply about how precious human life is. I don't care if you're conservative or liberal or a socialist. Like, this should be something that is apolitical. Everyone should acknowledge the tremendous value in human life. And it shouldn't just take a global pandemic for us to realize how important human life is. And not just making sure people are alive, but that they can thrive, you know, making sure that during these times of crisis, people aren't left wondering, what am I going to do? Who's going to be there for me? So, I mean, this has kind of gotten me thinking deeper about this just because it's personal. Like, for me, I told everyone my father passed away less than 2 weeks ago, and we've been, my family has been basically rushing to plan the memorial service for my dad, but we had to cancel it due to COVID-19. In Oregon, our governor issued an executive order, rightfully so, that, you know, bans events with more than 25 people, because what else do you do? You have to have social distancing. But, you know, for people in my family who are taking this really, really bad, you know, for example, my brother, one of my sisters, like, what do you do in this situation for them? They can't really go to a doctor, because they don't want to expose themselves to other illnesses. The memorial service is, you know, that was going to be like a way that all of us can feel a little bit of closure, but now that's gone. So, you know, it's not just that COVID is going to cause these types of issues for people. People already were dealing with things. Imagine if you already had cancer or you're on dialysis and now you look at COVID and you're worried about catching that. Like, some people can't stay home. As much as you say stay home, everyone should stay home as much as they can. Like, my dad, before he died, he was on dialysis for 15 years, and he can't stay home. You know, in that situation, if you stay home from dialysis, like, you die. It's just a matter of time to where your body basically poisons itself, because you need that machine to act, you know, to be your kidney. So there are people who are already vulnerable, and this just makes them more vulnerable, right? So we have to think deep and, you know, comprehensively about the way that the crisis causes other crises and how it exacerbates issues that people already have. And I just, like, the main takeaway to kind of, like, wrap this all into one little bow and give you a nice little package to take away is that human beings have a lot of needs, and it's not just that we should make sure that those basic needs for human life are met, healthcare, you know, food, but they should be able to thrive. You know, outside of this global pandemic, when it goes away, why are we working 5 to 6 days a week? Human life is too precious to dedicate the majority of our time to work. Why are we burdening people with student loan debt that they will never pay off? These are things that you have to think about. These are things that you have to think about. And, you know, you don't have to agree with me about democratic socialism. You don't have to become an anti-capitalist. I just want you to think in terms of human need and really stop allowing the system to force you to believe that everyone is on their own, because we live in an interconnected globalistic society to where, you know, a lot of these things are going to impact all of us. It's not just going to be that that poor person down the street is going to struggle and starve. That person's crisis will impact all of us in a way. Because maybe that person works at the grocery store. We need groceries. Maybe that person is a healthcare professional. We all rely on each other, and this is why we have to turn away from this, you know, morally reprehensible yo-yo philosophy. You're on your own, and embrace wit, which is we're in this together. That's what I want people to really think about. And even though right now we're literally like distancing ourselves, we are at the end of the day in this together. And I just want people to think about why we need policies that reflect that philosophy, that, you know, of togetherness and just looking out for one another. And that's it. Maybe I'm rambling, you know, maybe I'm not making much sense, but I just think that, you know, we need to turn away from this economized version of human life and actually acknowledge that there's more that's more important than just money and capital and the economy. Surviving, not just surviving, but thriving is that's important, because we're all human beings. At the end of the day, we all want to have good lives. So we have to make sure that we fight to deliver that to everyone.